men that dream of playing pro ball one day and you live that dream, but actually your upbringing wasn't really a storybook life at all, was it?
No, I mean, it was a dream growing up in Southern California and wanting to play Major League Baseball because I came from such a broken, dysfunctional situation. My dad was an alcoholic and he used to beat me and said I would never amount to nothing. And my pain led me to my greatness, but my greatness would eventually lead me to my destructive behavior. And the failure of my life would be captured in the public eyes. And it really wasn't all that great. I mean, baseball was great, but that was my escape to get away because of the pain I was in.
So you went and had an incredible career as a pro baseball player, playing with the Mets, the Yankees, the Dodgers. Are you wearing your World Series ring right now?
No, I'm wearing my wedding ring.
Oh, okay. That's good. That one's even better now. And your wife's here, isn't she?
My wife, Tracy, is here with me.
Now, Daryl sometimes wears this World Series ring that is the most insane, insanely cool ring of all time. And it's big, too.
Dead air big. You know, I had a chance to play in 4 World Series and be able to accomplish a lot of great things as a Major League Baseball player. 8-time All-Star, 4-time World Series champ. Been privileged my whole life, lived behind community gates, millions of dollars, home and everything. But at the end of the day, I was empty on the inside. I didn't have what I needed on the inside. And, you know, we can accumulate all these great things, but if you don't have Jesus on the inside of you, you're not going to be well as a person. It doesn't matter what kind of material stuff you have. It's what we all search for. And I searched for so long to have such a relationship with God myself, but I didn't know him. I got to a place where I just didn't want to be a hypocrite no more. I didn't want to say I know Jesus, but I really didn't. I know him. I just know his name and everything, because when you truly know him, you become a true follower of Jesus, and the Lord allows you to be a vessel for him to be able to do great kingdom work. And it's never about us. It's always about leading other people to the cross so they can get saved and get set free from the bondage and the chains in their life.
Thank you.
were both 85. They'd been married 60 years. And amazingly, they both died on the same day, and they went to heaven. They were greeted by St. Peter at the pearly gates. He said, "Welcome to heaven. Let me show you your mansion that God has for you." They went into this beautiful, palatial estate, and he took them into the custom kitchen, and then up to the master bedroom, complete with jacuzzi and sauna. The old man was so excited, he said, "But wait, how much is this gonna cost?" Peter said, "Are you kidding, man? You're in heaven, it costs nothing." Then he took him outside of their palatial estate, and there was this incredible golf course. And basically, the course would change every week, sort of to be one of the great golf courses on earth. And the old man said, "What are the green fees?" Peter said, "What's wrong with you? You're in heaven. There's no green fees. It's all free." And then Peter took them to this amazing, sumptuous feast. All kinds of amazing food. And the old man looked at it and said, wait, where's the low-fat food and the food for people who have high cholesterol?" Peter said, "Are you kidding? We don't have low-fat food. This is heaven. You can eat whatever you want and you'll never get fat." All the fat people are applauding. No, I'm kidding. Don't hate me. So the old man takes off his hat, throws it on the ground, starts stomping on his hat. Peter is looking at him and says, "Man, what's wrong with you?" The man turned to his wife and he says, "If it wasn't for your blasted bran muffins, we would have been here 10 years ago." Now that, of course, is not a true story. That's just a joke. But heaven is no joke. Heaven is a real place. Most people believe in heaven. In fact, 81% of Americans believe there is a place called heaven. 69% believe there's a place called hell. I read an interesting book that talked about how people who are at the end of life, people that are in the dying process, have three questions they ask most commonly. They ask these questions of the clergy, and they ask them also of hospice workers. Here are the three questions people ask when they come to the end of life. Number one, what's gonna happen to me after I die? Number two, is there really a God? And number three, will I be going to heaven? I'm gonna answer all of those questions in this message that I'm calling Happiness, Hope, in Heaven. And I wanna talk to you about heaven. Because deep down inside, I think you already know it's real. You're sort of pre-wired to want to go there. It's almost like we have a built-in homing instinct leading us to heaven. The Bible even says God has set eternity in the heart of each person. It was Augustine who said, quote, "You formed us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you." That's why there's a restlessness in your life. That's why those things that you get don't satisfy you in the way you hope they would. That's why you're always in sort of a search mode. C.S. Lewis once said, and I quote, "There have been times when I think I do not desire heaven, but even more often I find myself wondering in my heart of hearts if I've ever desired anything else." C.S. Lewis says, it's the secret signature of each soul, the incommunicable and unappeasable want, end quote. Reminds me of a story of a little boy that was flying this kite. It got him so high he couldn't see it anymore. The clouds were obscuring it, but he still was holding onto the string. Someone said, "Boy, is your kite still in that string?" He says, "Oh yeah, it's there, but you can't see it." The little boy says, "No, but I feel its tug." And I think deep down inside you feel the tug of heaven. You know there is more to life than you're experiencing right now. I remember when I was a little kid, and I went to Disneyland. That's back in the days when we had ticket books. I don't know if any of you remember those. And there was something called the E-ticket, okay? So the E-ticket, that got you on the really good rides like the Matterhorn. Well, they don't have those ticket books anymore. But I remember as a kid, to me, going to Disneyland was like a little bit of heaven. Let me tell you why. I had an alcoholic mother. I never had a father. My mom was divorced and married 7 times. I came out of this crazy home of fighting and arguing. And so it was just really for me like the happiest place on earth. But you know, as you get older, you change your attitude. I think the happiest moment for kids is when they go into Disneyland, and the happiest moment for adults is when they leave Disneyland, right? But the point is it was just a little glimpse of something greater to come out there. Here's what Jesus says about it. Don't let your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, and were it not so, I would have told you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. And the way you know. And then Thomas said, we don't know the way. And Jesus said, it's right here in the front of the stage. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father but by me. Yes, heaven is real. And you know what? I know that I will go to heaven when I die. You say, well, that's kind of arrogant, isn't it? No, it's not at all. I just know it. How do you know? Well, the Bible says his spirit bears witness with my spirit that I am a child of God. I know. How many of you know that you're going to heaven? Raise your hand tonight. That's a lot of you. There's some of you that didn't raise your hand because you're not sure. But you can know. This is called hope. And we need hope today. Generation Z has been described by experts as the hopeless generation. Are you hopeless tonight? If you put your faith in Jesus Christ, I'm telling you, you can have hope. Don't put your hope in technology. Don't put your hope in material things. Don't put your hope in politicians. Don't put your hope even in religion. Hope has a name, and it's Jesus Christ, and he's here tonight with us, and he's ready to change the course of your life. So I want to talk a little bit about heaven. I've always believed in heaven, of course, as a Christian. I've always talked about it, my messages. I was interviewed a while ago, and an interviewer said to me, Greg, it seems to me you talk a lot about heaven. Why is that? Well, I'd never really thought about it. But then when I considered it for a moment, I thought, well, what's more important than where we spend eternity? People have asked me, because this is our 30th anniversary, Greg, why do you keep doing these crusades year after year? Here's my answer. I keep doing these crusades year after year because I want to take as many people with me to heaven as I possibly can. And I've started thinking more about heaven, especially 11 years ago. Because that was the day my son Christopher left this world for the next one. You know, Christopher was always a very fast runner. In fact, when he was in high school, he was a track and field runner, long distance. Now, when I was in high school, I was a good short distance runner. So I would race him on the beach and other places. And I'd always say, Christopher, let's race. And I would always pick a spot that would favor me as a short distance runner. Let's run to that mark right there. Every time I beat him, and I loved it. Then one day I'm walking with him on the beach. He's a young man now. He's probably in his early 20s. They said, okay, Christopher, let's race to that spot right down there. On your mark, get set, go. And off we went. And he left the old man in the dust. He beat me. From that point on, I couldn't keep up with him. Well, he finished his race before I did too. The Apostle Paul said, I fought the good fight. I kept the faith. I finished the race. Henceforth, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness. My son beat me to heaven. But I think about him all the time. And I wonder, what's he doing up there in heaven? What is heaven like? What do we do each day in heaven? And so this is something I want to talk to you about tonight. What is heaven like? I'm going to give you a one-word answer. What is heaven like? Answer, amazing. Beyond your wildest dreams. I want you to realize this simple fact. Heaven is a real place for real people to do real things. Heaven is not like a watered-down, diluted version of Earth, like this is amazing and heaven's, well, just kind of boring. You know, we have this weird concept of heaven that's reinforced by movies and songs, and we think we just sit around in heaven on big fluffy clouds and take super long naps. We wake up, pluck our harps a little bit, fall asleep again. There's little fat baby angels floating around us. I don't know what they're all about, but I've seen them in religious paintings. And we say, man, I don't really know if I want to go to heaven. Well, that's not biblical heaven. That's not the real heaven. The real heaven, as I said, is a place. Jesus said, I've gone to prepare a place for you. The Bible says that heaven is like a paradise. Do you remember what Jesus said when he hung on the cross? And on each side of him were thieves, actually, probably murderers. We might call them terrorists today, because the Romans didn't crucify thieves, but they did crucify insurrectionists, and that's probably what these guys were. And one of the men realized that he was in big trouble, facing eternity, and he joined the other thief in mocking Jesus and saying, hey, you saved others, why don't you save yourself? If you're really the Son of God, come down from that cross. And then Jesus says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Right there, one of those men believed. Right there, just like that. And by the way, that's how long it takes to believe. It can happen in a nanosecond. You can come in here as a non-believer. I don't believe any of this. This isn't real. And all of a sudden, something is said, something happens, and the light goes on and you realize, oh wow, this is all true. The man turns to Jesus and says, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, truly, truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. What is heaven? It's a paradise. The Apostle Paul was stoned on one occasion, not that kind of stone, I mean with rocks. He was left for dead. It's at that moment most Bible scholars believe he died and went to heaven, because he did say he died and went to heaven and came back again. And in that moment, Paul describes it later, and he says, I don't know how this happened exactly, but I was seized by Christ and swept into ecstasy to the heights of heaven. I don't know if I was in my body or out of it. God knows, but I'll tell you this much. I was hijacked into paradise, and I heard the unspeakable spoken, and I was forbidden to tell what I heard. Heaven is paradise. Think of the most beautiful place you've ever been. Think of the most beautiful film you've seen of the most beautiful place, or a photograph. Heaven is far greater than that. It's paradise. But the Bible also says heaven is a city. You know, I like to go to beautiful places like Hawaii. I've been to Tahiti. That's nice. But I like to go to cities too. I enjoy cities. Like to look at museums. Like to eat food. Like to drink coffee. Like to eat food, like to walk around, like to eat more food. So heaven's a city. The Bible tells us this. It tells us it's a city whose builder and maker is God. So think about cities. Think about cities you've read about, or maybe cities you've been to. Well, heaven is a city as well. Guess what? There's things to do in heaven. You can get together with loved ones who have preceded you and have died in faith, and you can have meals together. You can reminisce together. You can do things together. We might even go to concerts. There's some pretty amazing musicians in heaven. You might run into some friends and say, where are you guys going? Oh, we're gonna go see Handel's Messiah. And Handel himself is gonna conduct it. Oh, wow. I'm going to a different concert. Where are you going? I'm gonna go see Johnny Cash. He's doing a concert right over here. You mean the man in black? No, he's the man in white now. They don't wear black in heaven, was Haken. Yeah, the man in white. Yeah, you're actually saying, Greg, you think we're gonna eat meals in heaven and maybe go to concerts? Yeah, I'm saying that and more. Heaven is a happy place. Heaven is a joyful place. Heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. Are you going to heaven? You can. I think it's possible heaven is watching us right now. You know, we talk about angels. This is Angel Stadium. The angels play here, but the angels are here. I'm talking about the angels of God are here right now with us. You say, well, what do you mean heaven is watching? Don't they have better things to do? Well, the Bible says that there is joy in heaven in the presence of the angels over one sinner that comes to repentance. Is it possible that if someone believed in Jesus here tonight, that had been prayed for by their grandparents or their mom and dad, and maybe their grandparents or mom or dad have gone to heaven, but then you believe tonight? Is it possible that that loved one that's preceded you to heaven would know? Well, listen, if a big giant party is going on next door, will you know? Years ago, I was doing a crusade, and I was going to bed for the night. It was around 10:30, and I heard some music start up in the room next to me. I mean, this was loud music. It was thump, thump, thump. It's like the walls were vibrating. I'm like, what the heck is going on? What kind of a sound system do they have? And it got louder and louder. Finally, I called the front desk and I said, there's something going on next to me. Can you please tell them to quiet down? And don't tell them I called you, okay? So then security comes up. I'm looking through my little peephole. And I see them knock on the door. The door opens. And I realized what was going on. A guy was having a bachelor party. He had a sound system, a DJ, lights, and all these people kept coming out. No wonder it was loud. They were having a party. There's a party in heaven every time someone believes in Jesus. Why wouldn't you know about that? I think you would. You see? People say, well, we recognize one another in heaven. Do you think you're going to be more stupid in heaven than you are on earth? Well, maybe I should ask, do you recognize one another on earth? No, I haven't seen them. Well, it'll get better. Yes, you'll recognize one another in heaven. Yes, you'll be reunited with loved ones in heaven. It's going to be amazing. Let me come back to those questions I raised in the beginning. Three of them. What's going to happen to me after I die? Is there really a God? And am I going to heaven? Let's take that first question. What's going to happen to me after I die? Well, your body will go into the ground. And your soul will enter the afterlife. I heard about a pastor that was presiding at the funeral of a man who had died. So he was trying to illustrate. He just thought of this illustration on the spot. And so he described the man's body as a shell. There in the coffin in front of the platform. He says, here in this coffin is just a shell. The nut has gone. That's not the way he expected that to turn out. That's pretty accurate. The nut is gone. Your soul will go on immediately into the presence of God if you are a believer. And then ultimately God will give you a new body. My granddaughter Allie, who's here tonight, was with me the other night. She looked over at me with sort of a sad look on her face. She said, Papa, why do we have to die? And I think what she was really thinking about is, Papa, you look like you're going to die soon. Papa, why do we have to die? Then she asked, why can't we just float up to heaven? Good question. The answer to that is because our first parents, Adam and Eve, sinned. And thus sin entered the human race. It was never God's intention that men and women would die. In the Garden of Eden, there was no death. There was no pain. There were no tears. There were no police officers. But mankind rebelled against God because he had a will of his own. And that rebellion is called sin. And because of that sin, now we have death. If Adam and Eve had not sinned, we would have never died. If Adam and Eve had not sinned, we would never get sick. If Adam and Eve had not sinned, we would not age. If Adam and Eve had not sinned, I would have hair right now. But they did. And sin, like a disease, entered the human race, and we're all born with it. We're not sinners because we sin. We sin because we're sinners. It comes naturally. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But listen, if you're a Christian, death is not the end. The Bible says the world with all of its desires is passing, but he that does the will of God lives forever. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Then he followed that statement up with a question, which was, do you believe this? And I'm asking you tonight, do you believe this? I reminded my granddaughter Allie of the time we were walking on the beach and I stepped on a bee. Now my wife kept saying, careful, there's bees on the beach. And I won't step on one. And then I stepped on one right after she said that. And it hurt. I even went to the lifeguard station, help me, a bee sting. And I reminded her, remember when I stepped on that bee? She said, yeah. And my foot swelled up just a little bit. But I took that stinger. I said, this is what happened. When Jesus died on the cross, he took the sting of death. And that is why the Bible says, oh grave, where is your victory? Oh death, where is your sting? Death died when Christ rose. You live forever as a Christian. That's the hope that the Bible gives us. That brings me to the second question. Is there really a God? The Newsboys reminded us, God's not dead. He's surely alive. There is a God and he's here tonight. I'll take it a step further. Some of you who say you don't believe in God, right now, you are aware of the presence of God. You say, there's something different here and I don't know what it is. That's the Lord. He's here. He's here. Jesus said, when two or more are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of it. Jesus said, or the Bible says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked man forsake his thoughts and turn to God who will pardon you. God is near tonight. God is here tonight. God is ready to change you tonight. But you need to reach out to him and say, Lord, I want to know you. Yes, God is real. But don't wait till you die to figure that out, because then it will be too late, because every man and every woman will stand before God at what the Bible calls the great white throne judgment. And if your name is not found written in the book of life, as it's called, the Bible says you'll be cast into the lake of fire. Now some of you are saying, oh man, I was tracking with you till you said that. Amen. It's the gospel truth. I'm not going to leave that part out, because it's hard to swallow. It's real. I don't care if 69% of Americans believe in hell and more believe in heaven. Hell is as real as heaven. Hell is as eternal as heaven. And the last thing God wants is for any person to go to hell. That's why Jesus came to this earth on a rescue operation and died in our place. He came to pay a debt he did not owe, because we owed a debt we could not pay. Yes, God is real. One last question. People ask when they're dying. They ask ministers. They ask hospice workers. Here it is. Will I be going to heaven? That's entirely up to you. Heard about a preacher that was talking about heaven one night. And he said to his church, how many of you want to go to heaven tonight? Everybody shot up their hand, except one little boy. The preacher pointed at the little boy and said, son, don't you want to go to heaven? And the little guy said, yes, I do, but I thought you were getting a load up tonight, you know. He didn't want to go quite yet. But listen, if you want to go to heaven, you have to be forgiven of your sin. Here's the weird thing. We think hell is for bad people. Heaven is for good people. And because I'm a good person, I'm going to heaven. Oh, yeah, says who? Is this your definition of good? Well, yes, it is. Well, we have to go by God's definition. Listen, we wouldn't know anything about heaven if we didn't read about it in the Bible. That's what we read about heaven. You can't just take heaven and come up with your own idea about it, your own way to get there. And so, it's not that hell is for bad people and heaven is for good people. Listen, this is gonna shock some. There's gonna be some good people in hell, and there's gonna be some bad people in heaven. Let me explain. We say I'm a good person. I'm a moral person. Yeah, but listen, as good as you are, you're not good enough to get to heaven, because everyone sins and falls short of God's glory. Everyone breaks his commandments. So there'll be some good, and I'll put that word in quotes, some good people in hell. At that, they were good enough to get there on their own. There's only one way to get to heaven, and that is through God's Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for you. But there's going to be some bad people in heaven. Now, by bad, I mean they were sinners. They did a lot of crazy stuff, but they asked God to forgive them. Thus, they're going to heaven. Heaven is not for good people. Listen, heaven is for forgiven people. And you can be forgiven of all of your sins tonight. Over the last couple of nights, we've seen 4,700 people walk forward and make a profession of faith to follow Christ. That can happen for you as well. Billy Graham was once doing a crusade in a small town. He wrote a letter and he wanted to mail it. And so he didn't know where the post office was. He found a little boy and he said, "Son, can you tell me where the post office is?" Little guy said, "Yeah, it's right over there, sir. Just go up that block, turn right, you'll see it." Then Billy Graham said, "Young man, I wanted you to know I'm preaching in a stadium in this city tonight, and I would like you to come and hear me, and I'll tell you how to get to heaven." The little boy said, "Why should I hear you talk about how to get to heaven? You don't even know how to get to the post office." How do you get to heaven? Number one, you have to admit you're a sinner. I've already pointed out the Bible says all have sinned and come short of God's glory. Every one of us have broken his commandments. Everybody needs forgiveness. But then the Bible says, if you will confess your sin, he is faithful and just to forgive you your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So some of you are saying, what do you mean confess? What do you mean forgive? And what do you mean by cleanse? Okay, confess just means you agree. So let's say you and I are standing here and we say, you know, well, it's a nice warm night here in Southern California. And you say, I agree. We agree on something. So to confess my sin means I agree with God about it. God says, I hate sin. You say, you know what, I hate it too. Okay, so you agree. If you'll confess your sin, if you'll agree with God, he's faithful and just to forgive you. What does that mean? Forgive means he's going to remove it from you. But listen to this. God doesn't just forgive you of your sin. He forgets your sin. As far as the east is from the west, is as far as God will put your sin for you. Our God has a big eraser, and he wants to use it in your life tonight. You can put your sin in your rearview mirror. Yes, it can happen for you. You have to admit you're a sinner. Then you need to understand Jesus died on the cross for you. What is God like? Jesus said, he that has seen me, has seen the Father. Jesus was God with a face. Jesus was God with skin on. Jesus walked this earth. He walked in our shoes. He breathed our air. He lived our lives. Then he died our death, and he rose again. What's God like? He's Jesus. Jesus is God. Who is Jesus? He walked this earth. He loved people. He forgave people. He reached out to hurting people, and he died for all people, including you and me. You have to realize Jesus died on the cross for you. The Apostle Paul said he loved me, and he gave himself for me. Yeah, it's true that God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. And whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. But don't forget this, Christ died for you. It wasn't nails that held him to that cross 2,000 years ago. It was love for you. Jesus said, greater love is no man than this, that he laid down his life for his friends. He laid it down. He died in your place. So what am I supposed to do about it, you ask? You need to repent of your sin. The Bible says God has commanded people everywhere to repent. What does that even mean? It means turn from your old life. It's actually a military term. You that are in the military understand this. It means an about face. So you're walking away from God. Now you're going to walk toward God. Then you must receive Christ into your life. This is what it means to be a Christian. It's asking God Himself to come and take residence in your heart. You say, what do you mean in my heart? Is Jesus going to get really small and climb inside of there? Heard about a little girl that was with her mommy, and she said, Mommy, where's Jesus? Mommy said, Jesus is in my heart. So the little girl put her ear up against her mommy's chest, and her mommy was a little bit hungry, so her stomach was gurgling, and her little girl says, Mom, it sounds like he's making coffee in there right now. This is a word picture. When we say ask Christ into our heart, what we mean is God literally comes and lives inside of you. That's why the Bible says you become a new person in Christ. Old things pass away. Everything becomes fresh and new. I love it right after it rains. For starters, everybody gets their car washed. But also, you might see a rainbow. Everything is clean and fresh. That's what happens when you believe. You go from black and white to living color. You go from death and destruction to life and purpose. It can happen for you if you will say, Jesus, come into my life and forgive me of my sin. And then you must do it publicly. That's why in a moment I'm going to ask you to do what thousands have done over the years and many have done in the last two nights. I'm going to ask you in a moment to get up out of your seat and walk down behind the stage, and when you all get here, I'll lead you in a prayer. You that want God to forgive you, you that want this relationship with Jesus, you that have maybe fallen away from the Lord, you need to make a recommitment to Him. I'm going to ask you to come. But why do you need to do it publicly? You might say, Greg, that's kind of a long walk. I'm up on the nosebleed section. Okay, it'll take you a little longer for sure, but it'll be worth it. Because Jesus said, if you confess me before people, which means acknowledge Him, own it. If you will confess me before people, Jesus says, I'll confess you before the Father and the angels in heaven. But then He added, if you deny me before people, I'll deny you before the Father and the angels. Is heaven watching us right now? Yes, it is. Is Jesus watching you right now? Yes, He is. And as you stand up for Him, He'll say to the Father, that's one of mine. That's what can happen for you. That's why I'm going to ask you to make a public stand for Christ tonight. One last point on, and I'm done. You must do it now. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Let me update it. Tonight is the night. Right now. Don't put it off till tomorrow or a week later or a month later. What if you never had another opportunity like the one you have tonight to ask God to forgive you? How sad it would be, how tragic it would be if you entered into eternity without believing in Jesus. Listen, He's just a prayer away. And I'm going to ask you to come to Him tonight. In a moment, we're going to pray. And then I'm going to invite you to leave your seat and come down on the field and make your public stand to follow Jesus Christ. Let's all pray. Father, now I pray for every person here. And I also pray for every person that is listening. If they do not know you yet, if they're not sure their sin is forgiven tonight, if they need to come to you or come back to you, would you help them to do that right now? But we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah.
love for you. Never ending, overwhelming. The Bible tells this story. Actually, Jesus told this story to show us what God is like. He told the story of a father who had two sons. One was a very bad boy. We call him the prodigal son. He ran away from home. He blew the family fortune, drugged the family name through the gutter, hung out with hookers, drank, lost all of his money, ruined his life. And one day he came to his senses and he said, you know, I had a really good back at my father's house. I'm gonna go home again. I'll never be a son anymore. I'll just like serve dad like one of the hired hands, but I'm gonna go home. Jesus says, while the boy was still a great ways off, the father saw him and ran to him and threw his arms around him and kissed him and said to everyone, rejoice with me, my son who is dead is alive again. He who was lost is found. That's how God feels toward you. If you'll come to him, say, I'm sorry, God, he'll run to you. He'll throw his arms around you. The never-ending, reckless love of God. And if you've fallen away and you feel ashamed, have done stupid things, you can come back to the Lord again. God says, return, you backsliding children, and I will heal you, says the Lord. But you must come. Jesus says, come to me. Come with your problems tonight. Come with your addictions tonight. Come with your doubts tonight. Come to Jesus. Don't try to clean your life up and come to Christ. Come to Christ and he will clean your life up. You just come. So as Phil and the band sings, get up, step into that aisle, make your way down to the field, and make your public stand to follow Jesus Christ.
Down, that you won't sit down, coming after me.
tonight. This is the night your life changes for time and eternity. So, let's get to it. As I pray this prayer, I would like you to pray it out loud after me. Mean it from your heart. Pray it after me if you would. Let's all bow our heads. Pray these words out loud if you would, please. God, I'm sorry for my sin. But I thank you for sending Jesus Christ, the Son of God, to die on that cross for my sin. I turn from that sin. I choose to follow Jesus from this night forward as Savior and Lord, as my God and my friend. Thank you for hearing this prayer. Thank you for answering this prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you.